Assalamu alaikum everyone, welcome to another ATP video.
In today's video, we will continue our series on intestinal nematodes. So,
without further ado, let's begin with a quick recap. Generally speaking, parasites can be divided into two main groups, protozoa and helminths. Helminths are then subdivided into two big groups, platyhelminths, which are flatworms, and nematodes, which are roundworms. The platyhelminths group is further categorized into cystodes, which are tapeworms, and trematodes, which are flukes. Keep in mind that worms infections are often accompanied by eosinophilia. We know they seem a lot, but the good news is that we in ATP have already done videos on all of them. So don't worry, you can easily cover them. In this video, we will complete our series and talk about nematodes. The first nematode on the list is Strongyloides tercorallis. It's strong, and it's a thread worm, and that is its second name. Strongyloides has many species, but Strongyloides tercorallis is the one that commonly affects humans. For its life cycle, similarly to hookworms, it starts from the soil, where filariform larvae penetrate the skin, and then migrate to the small intestine, where they mature. The adult worm produces eggs that develop into the next stage, which is the rhabditoform. These can either develop into filariform larvae, and can reinfect humans, or get excreted into the stool to form either adults and eggs or mature into filariform larvae, and the cycle continues. It might sound a bit complicated, but look at this beautiful illustration and I'm sure you'll understand it. And if you don't want to, that's fine, we got you. For the clinical practice and exams, the most important thing to remember is that filariform larvae is the infective stage, while rhabditoform larvae is the diagnostic stage. For the clinical importance, Strongyloides tercorallis can go to different parts of the body, so the problems depend on where they go. So they can affect the GI, respiratory, and cutaneous systems. And this is similar to hookworms problems that we discussed previously. Strongyloides tercorallis can cause cutaneous larva currents, which has rapid migration and perianal involvement, as opposed to cutaneous larva migrants caused by hookworms. Lastly, Strongyloides tercorallis can cause autoinfection, as we have seen in its life cycle. For the diagnosis, we look for rhabditoform larvae seen in feces under microscope. Then we have Trichinella spiralis. This worm can be found in pigs, rodents, and carnivores. Pro tip, always link spirals to striated muscles, which is where it's found in animals and the structure that it invades in humans. Trichinella spiralis is transmitted through ingestion of undercooked meat, pork in particular, or other infected animals. Less likely, it can be a result of fecal-oral route. Please note that although both ways include oral ingestion of encysted larvae, they are considered different. Fecal-oral route requires a cycle of oral ingestion and then fecal excretion, which can transmit the pathogens to other humans, similar to what we saw in Enterobius and Ascaris. After the encysted larvae is ingested, it will go to the small intestine where it will mature. Then, adult forms will produce new larvae which will start the journey to invade striated muscles, mainly skeletal, but can also target cardiac muscles. Now for the clinical importance, Trichinella spiralis can cause trichinosis or trichinellosis, which is characterized by fever, GI symptoms, in addition to myalgia and periorbital edema. Some patients might end up with cardiac or respiratory complications due to muscle involvement, and that can be fatal. For diagnosis, we can use serology. However, muscle biopsy is warranted sometimes to diagnose Trichinella spiralis, where it will show encysted or encapsulated larvae inside the muscle. Now for the last intestinal nematode of today, we'll be talking about Trichuris trichiura. Trichuris trichiura is also known as whipworm. For its life cycle, it's simple. It's transmitted through fecal-oral route, through contaminated food ingestion, or touching soil that has Trichuris trichiura eggs in it. The infective stage is embryonated eggs, whereas the diagnostic stage is unembryonated eggs. Embryonated and unembryonated simply mean having embryo or not, respectively. For the clinical importance, Trichuris trichiura infection oftentimes goes unnoticed, since it's asymptomatic. However, some patients might have loose stool with blood in it. In children, it can lead to anemia and rectal prolapse. For the diagnosis, similar to most intestinal nematodes, Trichuris trichiura diagnosis can be achieved by performing stool examination under a microscope, which will show unembryonated eggs. Lastly, for prevention, good hand and food hygiene can always reduce risk in getting most of these worms. In addition to that, Avoiding walking barefoot in areas where these worms are common can also lower your risk. Alright, to sum it up, here's this table which shows the infective and diagnostic stage of each worm and the treatments next to them. And that's it for today. We hope you found it helpful. Let us know in the comments section what do you think about our videos. And if you have any suggestions, please feel free to mention them so we can improve in the future videos. Don't forget to like, share, and subscribe to receive our latest explanations. And as always, thanks for watching.